And I know that we're in for a treat this morning, as our own beloved Reverend John allows Spirit to speak through him, to be that guiding light, to be that wisdom, to be those words that are going to enlighten us and uplift us and inspire us. Please help me and amaze. Please help me welcome Reverend John.
Sometimes when I'm introduced, I don't recognize myself. Good morning, friends. And it's a joy for me to add my own words of welcome and to say what a joy it is to hear Maestro playing behind me. Again, welcome, Maestro. And welcome to those people who I haven't seen for a while, who have been away and who are back and with us. So you know who you are and you're in my heart, and it's wonderful to have you here at service this morning. I listen deeply to this song of my soul, and I'm hearing your souls singing as well this morning. You know, I have a good friend who lives overseas and who always signs off his emails, Skype and FaceTime conversations with an old Jamaican expression, I don't know if you know it, more time. Every time we talk to him and he's going off, he says, all right, John, more time. We were on Skype a couple of weeks ago, and I was telling him about our outreach in the prison and about all the exciting classes that we're doing here at the Temple of Light that we're offering between now and the end of the year. And I decided to ask him a question, which I actually will be posing to our Principles of Financial Freedom class this Tuesday evening. And the question is this. If you could wave a magic wand and change one thing about your life, what would it be? If you could wave a magic wand and change one thing about your life, what would it be? I see a youngster who I've known from, he was a toddler, sitting in front, and I know if you could wave a magic wand, he would be at home in his bed right now, but never mind, you will survive, Bryce. Welcome. My friend replied, all right, John, more time. So I thought he had finished the conversation and hadn't heard me. So I said, okay, bye, talk to you soon. To which he said, well, you're gone already? You're gone already? Just so? You asked me a question, and I'm saying I would like more time. More time to do the things that are really important. Oh, sorry, I thought you were signing off, I said. So we chatted about having more time. And when we eventually hung up, I started thinking about this issue of time, and I've titled my encouragement this morning.
More time.
More time. But I'm not going just yet. More time. More time. More time. So many people tell me they need more time. They're desperate for more time. And one of the paradoxes, I think, of our modern era is that even though we have devoted an unbelievable amount of energy in inventing time-saving devices, so many people feel totally bereft of time. They wake up in the morning and they hit the deck running. They know at one level that they need to devote time to their spiritual practice. But how can I, Reverend John? They plead. The homework that your classes alone take up a big chunk of my time. But you know, friends, after meditating on this idea for a while, I've begun to see that it was time itself, it is time itself, and not the lack of time that is frustrating the efforts of many people to live more realized and fulfilled lives. Instead of using time, the majority of people are used by time. The issue then is not so much of time management, but is rather one of self-management. You know? We need to ask ourselves, how can I better manage myself in the time available to me? And we all have the same amount of time, don't we? It's a construct. It's a human construct. An enlightened perspective has to put time in its place. So let's go back for a moment to the Garden of Eden episode in Genesis, where we see symbolized the birth of what I'm going to call the egoic consciousness, the birth of the ego, the birth of the mind that measures, judges, and evaluates all the time. According to the story, Adam and Eve eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. But far from this being the first so-called sin, this is symbolic of how we began to develop into human beings. In fact, although their act was labeled the fall, it wasn't a fall at all. It was really a rising to a higher consciousness. The ego, then, is actually a great leap forward in terms of human consciousness. And the only thing wrong with ego is its attempt to portray itself as the be-all and end-all of consciousness, which it is not. At last Tuesday's spiritual enrichment service, and I agree with Carol, if you haven't been to a Tuesday evening service, treat yourself to a midweek, really inspiring, short pause that refreshes spiritually. Last Tuesday, Sharon Thomas spoke of our need to learn how to regard the ego in the correct perspective and to use it rather than to let it use us. Ego consciousness has been described by some scholars as a kind of evolutionary midlife crisis. It tries to convince us that it should be in total control of our life, that we don't need to have a spiritual practice because we are already okay. Sometimes when people haven't been to church for a long time and I call and say, I haven't seen you, they say, it's okay, I'm working on myself, I'm okay. You see, whenever I hear that, I know they're in desperate need of coming here and just getting an injection of the group consciousness that we bring together. Coming here is not just to come and learn more or to hear more of the same thing every Sunday. It's also a coming together to share in our consciousness this deep, deep something that happens that is greater than the sum total of our individual parts. There's kind of this coming together that is really strengthening and uplifting. And so the ego consciousness and the midlife crisis is perhaps something that we need to pay a little more attention to. It's kind of like when, you know, your seven-year-old tries to convince you to let him drive your car. When that happens, you don't throw the kid out of the car or hope that he will die or she will die or just go away. Ego is like that. You don't have to get rid of it or try to kill it. You should actually love it, but never give it the keys to your car. Never let it drive your life. What we call rationality is mostly our ability to measure, compare, judge, predict outcomes, and choose, isn't it? In a sense, if ego is measurement incarnate, then the firstborn son of the ego is time. So in my view, time is an invention of the ego. If you doubt me when you're leaving the temple this morning, ask any of the Ponciana trees or the koi in our meditation garden, what is time? The question is only meaningful to our human egoic consciousness. I'm not dissing time, friends. Those of you that know me well know that I'm kind of strict about being on time. Time is relatively important for negotiating the mundane day-to-day activities we all face. And as I often tell my chronically late friends, when they are chronically late, they're setting a pattern of lateness in their good coming to them also. So we need to know how to use time effectively. Many of the great masters have taught that the present moment is perfect just as it is, and have urged us to be mindful of this moment as being the only time we really have. Unlike time-bound minds that are constantly measuring and which view life as one moment after another, kind of like beads on a string, transrational consciousness recognizes only one moment, only this moment. And this very moment is always seen as absolutely perfect. That's if you are in the moment, though, and not thinking about what just happened or what is going to happen in the next moment. There's a Taoist parable that beautifully illustrates this enlightened perspective. As the story goes, a monk saw an old man on the other side of a raging river. The river was filled with huge boulders and jagged rocks, and it was pounding out of the mountain with a deafening roar. The old man was walking dangerously close to the edge of the cliff, and then all of a sudden, he slipped, he stumbled, and toppled into the white water like a stone. The monk saw this and, in horror and compassion, began to intone the chant for the dead. But to his amazement, the old man just shot out of the river downstream on the monk's side of the river. The old man landed on both feet, none the worse for the experience. A little wet, but none the worse. Well, as you can imagine, the astonished monk scurried down to the old man because he just had to find out how he had accomplished this incredible feat. "Oh, it was really nothing," said the old fellow. "I just went in with a swirl and came out with a twirl." The parable is a deep teaching on the power of saying yes to every moment. The old man would have been ripped to shreds in the river if he had resisted it in any way. He had obviously trained in the art of great relaxation. Even though the parable is used as a teaching story to establish this enlightened perspective of non-resistance, in real life, I'm sure many of you have read stories or heard stories of children, babies, and sometimes drunks who have survived car crashes simply because they offered no resistance to impact. One of my favorite films, and one which won many Academy Awards a few years ago, portrayed this same enlightened perspective of life. I believe the main reason the film Forrest Gump captured so many Oscars was that it contained this same paradoxical wisdom. If you don't resist the flow of life, you will survive. You will not only survive, you will thrive. Just like the old man in the Taoist parable, Forrest is totally open and goes with the flow in all situations. You see, his mama taught him this wonderful life lesson by using a box of chocolates. Forrest knew that life was unpredictable. He said, "You never know what you're gonna get." But far from turning him into a phobic and worrisome or passive person, Forrest became a person who acted decisively and often acted heroically. Forrest knew that no matter what piece of chocolate he chose, it would be just perfect. And note here, Forrest chose. I think we need to think about this, because the truth is, we always choose. And if you don't like what you have chosen and you have taken a bite, do you have to eat the whole thing?
No.
No? What do you do? Choose again. It's as simple as that. We are never stuck with our choices. So this brings me to your assignment. Regulars at the Temple of Light Center for Spiritual Living in beautiful Jamaica knew I always give an assignment which takes time. But your assignment this week is a pleasurable exercise in mindfulness. Your mission, should you decide to undertake it, is to buy a small box of chocolates or bag of chocolate kisses. Uh-huh. But here's the thing. Stop everything you are doing and mindfully eat one. Just one. Every day this week. Just one. Yes, Cherry, you can do it. And as you savor the taste of the one you have chosen, say these six words over and over. And if you have a pen, write them down. Say these six words until the chocolate is completely dissolved in your mouth. And here's what you're to say. Just this. Right now. Just this. Just this. Right now. Just this. If you can't eat chocolate, do it with grapes or any other small, delicious morsel. New Thought author Dennis Mary Jones, who is a friend of the Temple and actually who installed Reverend Michael, Reverend Sonia, Reverend Anne, and myself when we first became ministers, has written a wonderful book on mindfulness. And he says that mindfulness brings your beingness into your doingness. Mindfulness brings your beingness into your doingness. This is how he puts it, I quote, "The irony is our body can't be any place other than in the present moment." Right? Are you all here? Physically, yes. But some are thinking about the rice and peas that they have to put on when they go home, or what they want for lunch, or you've already gone to buy the chocolate kisses. Today, Lo Shushan sell out. But Mary Jones says, far too often our mind is elsewhere. Mindfulness is the practice of calling the thinking mind back to where the body is, wherein the two become as one in the present moment. As you incorporate your awareness of being present in the moment, your doing, which is who you are, becomes infused with your being, the what you are, as the activity at hand. Let me say that for you again. As you incorporate your awareness of being present in the moment, your doing, the who you are, becomes infused with your being, the what you are, as the activity that you're participating in at the moment. At this level of mindful living, your every action, Merritt Jones says, becomes a portal for a potential redefining moment, a moment in which you will have new insight into where you are and what you are doing in that very moment and who you are being. And so sometimes you can just stop and say to yourself, who am I being right now? You know, when you feel the anger rise and the bile in your mouth because somebody bad drive you and you're driving your new Chris Red car, just ask yourself as you draw gear, who am I being in the present moment? Sometimes your mind wanders to somewhere else and you think, oh God, I have to face this tomorrow. Ask yourself, who am I being right now? Have I put off the joy of experiencing this moment to worry about what might happen tomorrow, or the next day, or the next year? It really robs you of the joy of being and to listening deeply to the song of your soul. And so at the level of mindful living, your every action can really be an opening into what the possibilities are for you as a divine being, as a son or daughter of the living God. The primary thing, Mary Jones says, is to be present with what you are doing. And when you are, you will be amazed at what will be revealed to you, unquote. And so this week, practice mindfully savoring your chocolate and saying, what? Just this. Right now. Just this. Try being mindful also while you're having your meals. Don't sit before the TV mindlessly shoveling food into your mouth. Carefully observe the taste, the texture, the colors, and the shapes on your plate. And as you do, repeat your mindful mantra, which is just this. Right now, just this. Remember, friends, that when you do this, you are retraining yourself and bringing your authentic being into your human doing. And you can do it with every single task, washing the dishes, whatever you're doing, you can become mindful to that very moment and fill it with joy. If you can't stand doing the laundry, do the laundry in this mindful state and watch it change how you feel about having to do this task. The other thing I want you to remember, if you feel pressed for time this week, is that the universe is on your side. The universe is for you. It has your back. The universe supports you. You know, the story is told that shortly before his transition from this plane, the great Albert Einstein was asked by an interviewer. He said, "Mr. Einstein, of all the questions you have ever asked, what was the most important?" And I can just see the interviewer sharpening his pen, getting ready to write down something heavy about black holes and quasars. But instead, Einstein surprised him. He said, "Oh, that's easy." Einstein responded, "The question I would ask, is the universe a friendly place or not? Is the universe a friendly place or not?" The response, of course, from all the world's great mystics, saints, and philosophers in all traditions and across all cultures is simply yes. It can't do otherwise. The universe is always portrayed as a field of blessing, a field of absolute love, by the rare people who have broken through the veil of illusion that blinds the vast majority of human beings who are too busy being human doings to be human beings in the present moment that God has gifted them. One such rare soul who has seen through the veil into the eternal reality was Ernest Holmes, who gave the world the great teaching known as Science of Mind. In the foreword of his first book, Creative Mind, which was published in 1917, Holmes writes the following, and I quote, "The hand of eternal progress is brushing the cobwebs from the corridors of time and is again revealing to the human race the mysteries of being. As there is nothing new under the sun, the searchlight of truth is bringing to light only what has been known to the few in all generations. The time has now come when the few must become the many. The whole world, from the least to the greatest, must know the truth so that man may understand the great laws that govern his life. He must learn to control his own destiny, to heal his own body, and bring happiness to his own soul. Ignorance must vanish, and understanding must be ushered in. Man is no longer to be governed by anything outside himself. Creeds, doctrines, churches, institutions, organizations, governments are all being changed to give place to the realization of the individual. There is a power in and through all that is working this great transformation. All that will not measure up to the standard must fall by its own weight. All that is in line with the truth must still prosper. The time is at hand. We are in the greatest age of all history. We are in the age of the unifying of all people and all things into the ever-present one. The temple not made with hands is now being silently built by the emancipated souls of this planet." Unquote. The temple not made with human hands is now being silently built by the emancipated souls of this planet. See one here? Yes, friends, the time is at hand. Just look at your hands right now. Just look at your hands. The time is now. And we are the emancipated souls to whom Ernest Holmes refers. Let us be mindful of our responsibility to create a world that works for everyone. Let us trust the universe and trust our own authority and ability to manage the task of building the temple of our enlightened consciousness of oneness. One God, one mind, one infinite intelligence, one heart, one love, one world, one people. Please turn to your neighbor and say, deeply, we are one. Namaste. Deeply, we are one. Namaste. Deeply, we are one. Namaste. Friends, yes, deeply, we are one. Namaste. More time.